Hey, Dr. Sia with you. So what are the best thyroid levels? What are your optimal levels of thyroid values? Let's talk through that a bit. And I want to distinguish too, what do we mean by best? There's been an assumption that if you need to be in a certain range, that means that medications are justified. And in this video, I'll explain to you how you can learn what are the best levels for you. And if you're not there, what might be the most effective ways that could get you there? Okay, so first off, let's think about the thought process itself. How would we know which levels are best? Well, the normal values in laboratory ranges are statistical averages. What that means is they'll take a population of people and they'll find what's the most common score and draw a bell curve distribution and see how much range would uncover 95 or 97.5% of those normal values. So that's fine. Now, the drawback is the population being tested may not be reflective of those who have the best health. In the case of tests that are done purely for screening, you know, you're checking the whole population, not a select group, and so that argument is not a concern. But in the case of diagnostic tests, like thyroid tests, that's different. The people that get the most tests are those who already have thyroid disease, and they're being monitored to see if their levels are working well. Furthermore, those that have the most unstable thyroid levels are apt to be tested the most often because they undergo the most dose adjustment. So when we think it through, we realize that this average we're looking at is an average of a very biased population. It's not the same as healthy people. There have been studies done that have looked at people who are free of thyroid disease, and those that are really by any thorough metric shouldn't have any thyroid problems. You know, those that have no known history, no family history, no big symptoms, no other medical conditions that would affect the thyroid. So one way we answer that question is by looking at the scores in those that lack thyroid disease. Now, another way we think about this is looking at people who have thyroid disease but have different health outcomes. So for example, you can look at those who have more weight problems or fewer weight problems and see if there are clear differences in their scores from one to the next. So that's the second source of data. The third source of data is those who have thyroid disease, and we can see how their health changes over long periods of time, their longer-term disease risks. You know, who amongst them gets the most heart disease, who has the most diabetes, and how, and those who have risks versus those who don't, how do their blood levels differ? So those big three pieces of data help us talk about what are optimal blood levels, you know, what are the best ones. So we know this: these blood levels predict overall quality of life, you know, better or worse symptoms, tendencies towards disease progression, whether the thyroid will heal or worsen, and then also the risk for other related diseases. This is relevant. Now, I want to distinguish when we talk further about initiating medication from titrating medication, because there's those who are already on medication and those who are not. And there are times in which someone who is not on medication may not have the best thyroid blood levels. And it could be really tempting to assume that if they were given medication to correct those levels, that would help them in some way. But the one doesn't always follow the other. There are many circumstances in which someone has thyroid levels that are not great, but if they were given thyroid medication, they wouldn't improve even if their levels improved. But now on the other hand, there's those who are already on medication and they might benefit by having their medication adjusted. So there's a big difference between starting medication and adjusting medication. And there's a difference between taking hormone and making it by yourself. So let's be clear on that. And I'll talk through about when levels would justify starting hormone and when they would justify initiating it or just changing it. So, and now we'll talk about the different thyroid values that are relevant. So for starters, let's talk about the main values that are going to be relevant. We have the TSH, the T3, the T4, the reverse T3, and the thyroid antibodies. For this discussion, I'll focus in on the markers of thyroid output, the TSH, the T3, T4, reverse T3. Let me quickly address a few variables with these. Reverse T3, I'm not going to spend a great deal of time on because we really don't have a body of data saying that there's optimal levels or not. We really don't. normal people make a lot of it, and they make very different amounts at different times. There are times when it is high, and those times can correlate with symptoms and health problems. But it's not that reverse T3 is causing the problem. It's a sign that there's something off with how the body is using thyroid hormones. Most commonly, there's just too much there. So let's just set that one aside for another discussion, because there's really not a big body saying that one should try to work to get reverse T3 in a certain range. That doesn't exist. Now, of T3 and T4, we can talk briefly about the idea of total and free. So there's total T4, total T3, and free T4, free T3. And when options are available, the free version of the test is more useful. By free, I don't mean the lab won't charge you for it. It means that these hormones are freely active. They're floating around loose. They're single and ready to mingle. The total hormone includes that free fraction, but also the hormone that's bound up and inactivated by carrier proteins. So there are some times where someone's got a lot of hormone, but not much of it available, or vice versa, not much hormone, but much of it available. So in most cases, the total amount of hormone is reflective of the free fraction, but in some outlying cases, it's not. So when all options are on the table, the free is more useful, and that's getting to be more and more standard. But the comments that I'll make next up will apply both to the free and the total. Okay, so first we'll talk about the TSH briefly. And this one, it's important to remember, is a backward marker. So the more your body lacks in thyroid, the higher your TSH goes. The more there's an excess of thyroid, the lower the TSH goes. And this is your brain, your pituitary specifically, asking your thyroid to work. So if your thyroid is lazy, it gets yelled at. If it's overactive, it gets ignored. So it's backward. Now, there's a lot of data saying that within the normal range, there's differences based upon which end you are. So most labs now call the normal range 0.45 to 4.5, or 0.4 to 4.5. Those are the typical numbers you see for the high and the low end of the range. And the data shows that those on the lower side generally do better. Do better, what does that mean? Less risk for thyroid enlargement, less risk for weight problems, less risk for heart disease, better energy levels, better quality of life. A lot of things are better when the TSH is on that lower side of normal. And this differs per age, gender, per population status, per pregnancy. But for most adults, that's somewhere between about 0.5 and 2. So somewhere in that range is where we see the best level of overall health. And that's true in those ways we talked about. That's how it looks in healthy people. That's how it looks in those with thyroid disease with lower symptoms. And that's how it looks in those with thyroid disease that have better long-term health outcomes. So, but we've got to distinguish though, does that mean you should start medicine if you're unmedicated and your TSH is at 3? No, there's no data saying that would help you. And we could take that further. I've talked in other videos about how with high levels of TSH, but normal T4, we call that subclinical disease, medicines still don't help. Now, they will change the numbers. I'm not denying they will change the numbers. They will, for sure. But they won't reverse the problems in almost all circumstances. So when we talk about optimal levels, that doesn't mean you start medication if you're not there. What can you do? We've got a lot of data about how powerful diet is now. There have been many studies showing that even with severely abnormal levels, they can improve for over 90% of people with iodine regulation. That was my main focus in writing the Thyroid Reset Diet, and it walks you through a simple protocol with meal plans and recipes that can reverse thyroid disease for the vast majority of people and improve TSH levels. So now let's expand onto T3 and T4. So the TSH was a backward marker to recap. So low thyroid means a high TSH, and too much thyroid means a low TSH. And healthier people have a lower TSH score. So all that stuff is true. So a lot of practitioners have taken those true things and they've then assumed that if healthy people have a low TSH, healthy people must have high levels of T4 and T3. Well, that's possible because there is, at the extremes, there is like this seesaw relationship between TSH and T3 and T4. If someone is horribly hypothyroid, Imagine someone's thyroid was taken out and they weren't given any medication. Their TSH would go up into the hundreds, and over the course of like 6 to 8 weeks, yes, their T3 and T4 would get low. And on the flip side of that, if someone had bad Graves' disease, they were badly hyperthyroid, and they weren't on any treatment, first their TSH would plummet and go down to 0.01, as low as possible, and then over the weeks, their T3 and T4 would elevate. So yes, there's this backward relationship at the extremes. However, that backward relationship only exists at the extremes. So someone to have a low normal TSH does not mean they should be expected to have a high normal T3. That doesn't follow. It could be logical, but again, that backward thing only works when you're through the roof too high or down in the basement too low. It doesn't work for the levels that are appropriate for day-to-day average health. And the way we thought about optimal for TSH, remember we talked about people that have no thyroid disease, people that have thyroid disease and different health outcomes. When we apply that same metric to T3 and T4, we find very different stuff. One thing we see is that people that have better health outcomes and lower symptoms tend to have low normal levels of T4. And they've got a large diversity in their T3. For some, it's low normal. For some, it's mid-range. Rarely is it high normal. Most commonly, it's middle to low. But there's an idea circulating that you have to have T3 on the high side of normal. No, you really don't. And there's a lot of evidence saying that people who do have higher levels of T3 are not the healthier people in populations. Those that are more apt to have high T3 are likely to have tendencies towards weight gain, towards fatty liver, towards higher blood pressure, and towards excessive visceral fat. So yeah, the mindset of thinking that T3 and T4 should be high just because TSH tends to run low, that's just not true. Now, the other mindset that we see, some assume that all these levels should be smack dab in the middle, not too high, not too low. And I see the logic in that. I can see the idea thinking that if there's a range and some people are on the high end or some are on the low end, and the middle must be best. Well, it seems like a simple principle, but when we look in more detail and look at studies of actual people, what we find is that the TSH, there's this low end of the range. And if things are off, people quickly go below range. So the healthier people are on the low end of normal, but they're not in the middle of normal. That's not a bad place, but it's just not the best place. And in terms of T3 and T4, there's really a lot of range in people. So yeah, the healthiest folks are often lower normal in T4, and they can be in a lot of places for T3. Some who look at this mid-range thing say your TSH should be 2 to 3, because that's the center of that 0.4 to 4.5. And that's a simple mathematical rule, but it's really not the most thoughtful way to evaluate that. That's not really looking at actual people. It's just plugging in some numbers. So yeah, not a good way to really base that. So my approach is to think about what happens in people that have no symptoms, that have good thyroid function, and of those who have thyroid disease, what happens, what are the levels found in those who are the healthiest and who don't get chronic disease and who don't have their thyroid disease progress and have the lowest level of other symptoms otherwise. So crunch all those things together, and this is what you get. We find the TSH is on the low side of normal, the T4 is on the low side of normal, and there's a big range for T3, like mid-range to low to sometimes on the higher part of mid-range. But these are things you don't need to force. They're things the body can bring back into balance with good health and with good diet. If someone is on medication, it can be worth adjusting to first get the TSH, that healthy part of the low end of the range. But even deeper than that, I would say, are they in a state that needs medication? And are they better off served by being on it? Because in many cases, they were put on it unnecessarily. So don't underestimate how powerful diet is. There's a lot of room for improving this. But yeah, that's a sense about what optimal thyroid levels can look like. All right, Dr. C with you. Take great care, and we'll talk in really soon.